Okay, good morning once again. Good morning all. So, just a quick confirmation. You are able to hear me, see me, and view the desktop, all the three.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So, any questions from the last class? So, we started with the introduction of post-independence history, and also we began with the reorganization of the states. So, any questions from the last class, please do let me know. Okay, let us begin for today's topic then. So,
It seems it's only the blank screen is visible for a few people, maybe.
okay, just a minute, it's loading. Now,
Now, fine, sir.
okay, thank you. Okay, so in the last class, what we were discussing is like the India which was like this in 1946, so which was having India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and also the way in which the princely states were there was completely different from the way India was from the, you can say, the commencement of the Constitution from 1950 January 26th. So once the constitution came into force, we decided to change the complete map of India, because we discussed that the way the British made the provinces in India, it is only for their administrative convenience. Now, when Indian constitution came into picture, now this because the aspects which became more important for the rulers are the welfare of the citizens and the welfare of the state. Now both became more important for the rulers of the country. That is why there is a complete transformation. Now, if you could recollect here, there were 11 provinces in the British India. Some were Hindu majority, some were Muslim majority. I hope we discussed in detail about all the 11 provinces. Okay, like the way they were formed, when Odisha was formed, when Bihar was formed, when Bengal was partitioned, when Bengal was united. I hope all this we discussed in the modern Indian history, and I hope you remember as well all this. Okay. Now, the India which was having 11 provinces, each provinces was having a governor, and at the top in Delhi there would be a governor general. Now, this India which was there in 1946, a portion would be cut off from India. That is what we call it as Pakistan. This particular portion became West Pakistan. West Pakistan, and this particular portion, what we today we call it as Bangladesh. Okay, this particular portion of this one, it became East Pakistan. Okay, now in addition to this, there was more than there was the, you can say, arrangement of princely states, which were more than 500 in number. Now, one after the other, during 1947 to 1950, a lot of princely states were integrated into India, except for few. Okay, those few we will discuss in detail after, maybe after this particular topic, integration of princely states. Now, here the administrative mechanism was A, B, C, and D. Could someone quickly recollect what is A, B, C, and D, and how many numbers were there? Can anyone from the last class? And yeah,
29, sir, 29.
29. Very good, perfect. And could you recollect what is A, what is B, what is C, and what is D?
Sir, A was governor's provinces,
Governor.
which were British provinces,
Very good.
and B was princely states. Almost more than 500 princely states were there, and then C was commissioner administered provinces, and the four was, I mean, D was the island of Andaman and Nicobar.
Nicobar, yeah, perfect, perfect, very good. Now, one small correction: the B, the number of princely states were 9, which were yet to be integrated. So already, out of 500 princely states, almost all princely states have integrated, but except for a few. Okay, so this would be 9 in number, this would be 9 in number, this would be 10 in number, and last one would be 1 in number. So in total, 29 in number. Okay, again, the numbers are not more important. Again, which are the princely states is also not important. We will cover the most, you can say, the troublemaking princely states. Okay, so the numbers are not important, but have an idea that India, after constitution commencement, it became like this with different administrative mechanism. Now, the first state to be created was Andhra state in 1953. Now, after this, the linguistic movements were on rise because the people in Gujarat, people today's Gujarat, they were integrated with Bombay. They felt that the Gujaratis were treated inferior to that of Marathis in Bombay. The same thing happened in a lot of other places in India. That is the reason the linguistic movements gained momentum. And also, some Congress leaders felt that language can be a solution for religion. Now, they felt that this is like a major threat to Indian nationalism. Now, to contain this Indian, the religious ill will against one particular community, they felt that language can be an, you can say, unifier rather than a divider. Now, that is why there were movements and to you can say so some of the committees constituted by government and Indian National Congress, we discussed also the Dhar Commission and the JVP Committee in 1949, and further later, after the creation of Andhra State, there was the formation of the most important commission, that is Fazal Ali Commission, which gave the recommendation that India can be reorganized on linguistic basis. Okay, the underlying keyword here is can. Okay, not shall. India, the language and culture can be the basis for the formation of the states. Now, that is what the discussion in the last class. And what happened from 1950 to 1956, that is also we discussed, like there were demands for creation of states, creation of the commissions by government and by the Congress party itself. Now, when India was created in 1900, when India was reorganized in 1956, there were 14 states plus 6 union territories. Now, from here, the journey also we have started from 14 to 28 and 6 to 8. Today, we are having 28 states and 8 union territories. So, any questions till now? Okay, good. Then we will go into what happened after 1956. Now, after the creation of the after the creation of the states and union territories on linguistic basis, now one after the other, the demands did not stop. The demands, they were subdued for time being, but they did not stop. And the first state to be created after linguistic reorganization was Gujarat in 1960. Gujarat came into existence from 1960. Nagaland in 1963. Again, I'm just giving one word, one line, or one word description of what happened. But if you go, that is a story in itself, like the Gujarat movement. That is a story in itself. Now, if you belong to any of those states where the linguistic movements have taken place, where state reorganization has been done, try to find out what are the reasons for the formation. Okay, and after the formation, what are the developments? Whether it was good, whether it was bad, or what was the impact of the creation? Okay. Then in 1966, the Hindi-speaking population was divided from Punjab. Okay, so Haryana became the 17th state. Okay, Gujarat 15, Nagaland 16, and Haryana 17. And further later, the hilly terrains of Punjab were separated, which we call today as Himachal Pradesh. This was made in 1971. Himachal Pradesh became the 18th state of India. And 1972, the whole map of Northeast was changed. Can someone recollect what states came into existence in 1972?
Only Nagaland, right?
Yeah, only Nagaland in 1963, but 1972, three more states came into existence. three other states? Okay.
Mizoram, Tripura, and Meghalaya.
Meghalaya, very good.
Mizoram, Arunachal Pradesh. Okay.
Yeah, it's Manipur, Meghalaya, and Tripura. Arunachal Pradesh and Mizoram were not given statehood. They were given union territory status in 1972. Now, how to remember? I told you the northernmost and southernmost. Okay, again, why this is the northernmost Arunachal Pradesh? Okay, the northernmost and the southernmost, because they were having a huge border with, this is having a huge border with China, this is having a huge border with Myanmar as well as Bangladesh, if you could see the map here. And because of the events which are happening in 1970s, they were kept still under the control of central government. That is why they were given union territory status, they were not given statehoods. Now Nagaland was formed in 1963 and Assam was already there. Now the remaining three states, Meghalaya, Manipur and Tripura, were given statehoods. I hope this is clear. 1971, the complete map of Northeast was changed. Then 1975, Sikkim was integrated into India. Sikkim was integrated into India. Now we will study the story of Sikkim in detail, why Sikkim has to be integrated into India. Okay, so before that, before we get into Sikkim, we'll just try to complete the flow of the formation. In 1987, Arunachal Pradesh and Mizoram became states as well as Goa. Now Sikkim was 22nd state, Arunachal Pradesh 23rd, Mizoram 24th and Goa 25th. And in the year 2000, three more states were created, Chhattisgarh, Uttarakhand and Jharkhand, becoming 26th, 27th and 28th states respectively. And in 2014, Telangana was created, becoming 29th state. And in the year 2019, Jammu Kashmir was bifurcated into the Union Territories of Jammu Kashmir and Union Territory of Ladakh. Okay, and with this, we have now come to 28 state and 8 union territories. Now, yesterday I have shared the Lakshmikant, the soft copy of the Lakshmikant. I hope everyone have received it. Now, I suggest to read the Lakshmikant for the chapters 1 through 5, whatever we were discussing. That would be a good start. It would be helpful in your quality paper as well. I do not want to overburden with a lot of other books. Okay, you can start with Lakshmikant only, which has dealt in detail with reorganization of the states. Any questions till now? Okay. Now, we will discuss about the story of Sikkim. Let me share the story of Sikkim. Now, why Sikkim was integrated into India? What are the reasons from the side of Sikkim side, and what are the reasons for India side? Now, the story of Sikkim is something very interesting, as well as a good example of the integration, how it has been done. If you see the map of India, okay, and if you identify the Sikkim here, you will notice that Sikkim is located at the borders of Nepal, Bhutan and also Tibet. Now Tibet was annexed by China. Tibet, earlier it was an autonomous region and later it became part of China, because China felt that Tibet was always a part of its territory. Okay, but during the British time, Tibet was like an independent country. But in 1950s, China became aggressive and China included Tibet in its provinces. And also in 1962, if you know that, there was a war where China has annexed a part of Ladakh, that is what we call it as Aksai Chin. Now China has a theory that is called palm and finger theory. China has a theory called palm and finger. Okay, just like you have the palm and finger, China believes that Tibet is a palm and there are five fingers for this palm. The five fingers are, the first finger is Aksai Chin, that is in Ladakh. Second finger is Nepal. Third finger, Sikkim. Fourth finger is Bhutan. And fifth finger is Arunachal Pradesh. Okay, part of Arunachal Pradesh. This it calls itself as South Tibet. It calls itself as South Tibet. Now, if you look like this, it is like a palm with five fingers. Aksai Chin, Nepal, Sikkim, Bhutan, and are part of Arunachal Pradesh. It calls this Arunachal Pradesh as South Tibet. Okay, sometimes it claims the whole of Arunachal Pradesh. Sometimes it claims a portion up till Tawang. I hope you know all the location of the map. Now, China became very aggressive in its expansionist policy. It wanted to integrate one after the other. Again, this is nowhere. The Chinese official policy does not claim all this. This is a media term. The palm and digit theory, palm and finger theory. Okay. Now, from here, the Bhutan, Nepal, all these Himalayan kingdoms, including Sikkim, was very much, you can say, they were under pressure from China. And this is on one side. Now, from Sikkim, from the point of viewpoint of Sikkim, now the China is very aggressive, and at any time it can take over into this one. It has already done in Ladakh, and many times it tried to ingress into Arunachal Pradesh. Now from Sikkim, there were demands that we should have closer relationship with India. Now if you see history of Sikkim, before 1947, that is before independence, Sikkim was a protectorate state. Sikkim was a protectorate state. Protectorate means the defense is under the control of the British. Everything apart from the defense relations and international relations, everything was internally governed, just like any other princely states. Sikkim was also part of the British India. Now, after independence, India tried to maintain the same status quo. That is what we called as protectorate state. That is, whatever it was there before 1947, Indian government said that Sikkim would be a protectorate state by India. So till 74, we followed the same pattern of administration. But in 74 to 75, between 74 to 75, the Sikkim Assembly passed a resolution saying that we want a closer relationship with India. So that is why in the year 74, the 35th Amendment Act was passed in Indian Constitution, and Sikkim was given a new statehood, that is what we call it as associate state. Associate state. That is, it is having closer ties with India, but unlike other states, it was given a special relationship that is called associate state. This was created by creating a new article in the constitution, that is called Article 2A, and a new schedule in the constitution, that is called 10th schedule. 10th schedule. Today, 10th schedule is dealing with a separate matter, that is called anti-defection law. But in 1974, after the 35th Amendment Act, the Article 2A deals with associate state, and 10th schedule deals with the matter of governance. Now, in 1975, the Sikkim Assembly passed one more resolution saying that we wanted a full-fledged relationship with India. Now, from here, Sikkim was given full statehood, and this relation was no longer required. That is why the 35th, that is 6th Amendment Act, repealed Article 2A and Schedule 10 of the Constitution. Now, Sikkim became 22nd state of India. 22nd state of India. In 1975. Okay, so I hope this is clear. The story behind Sikkim is clear. Now, why Sikkim wanted to become part of India? One of the major reasons is the expansionist policy of China, which the Sikkim believed that there is only one country which can protect us, the neighbor, that is India. That is why Sikkim wanted a much closer association with India. That is why the associate state and further full statehood was given to Sikkim. Now, from Indian side, why Sikkim is important? Why Sikkim is important? One reason is it is having now the buffer. Sikkim, the Tibet was like a buffer between India and China. But when China annexed Tibet. Okay, then it was at our doorsteps. Now, if you do not have good relations with Bengal, Nepal, or Sikkim or Bhutan, this would be a threat for internal security challenge. And I hope you know that India is connected to Northeast through a narrow corridor. Okay, this particular corridor. Okay, can anyone tell me what are the districts here? Which connects West Bengal to the Northeast? Okay, this particular corridor is called as the Siliguri corridor. Siliguri. Now, this particular corridor is very important from not only from international perspective but also for internal security perspective. The reason is it is a very narrow path. It is hardly 20 kilometers at its you can say the narrowest point, and it is surrounded by countries like Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, and earlier it was Sikkim. That means if Sikkim or Bhutan or Nepal fall to China, okay, if China occupies, just like it has occupied the Aksai Chin region, this would be a major threat for India, because the whole of Northeast would be separated from India if something happens to this particular region. So the connectivity to the Northeast can be disrupted if there is any problem here. That is why India do not want any security challenges in this vulnerable region, because this is the only way through which the Northeast is integrated. That is why after independence, the development of Northeast has taken a back seat. One reason is there was connectivity problems. That means whatever the connectivity is there, it has to pass through this one. And that too, and moreover, it is a very narrow place with a lot of internal security challenges. Now, this place in West Bengal is not only important from external challenges like Nepal or Bhutan or Bangladesh or from the earlier China, but also this particular place is also important from our internal security perspective. Like, if you know that in West Bengal there was communist government, okay, which was more sympathetic to the Maoist struggle. You know, there was Maoist struggle in India. Okay, that is what we called as Naxalism or left-wing extremism. So there were left-wing extremist movement in West Bengal with a base here. There are terrorist organizations which are having a base in Bangladesh, which target this particular location. And also, in addition to the left-wing extremist region and the terrorism, this also has seen the increase in drug trafficking. Okay, drug trafficking. Can anyone tell me why the drug trafficking is relevant in this particular region? I hope in India two places are very important for drug trafficking. Can anyone tell me which are those two places? See, one place is in Northeast, the other place is in the Punjab region. This is Punjab region and the other is in Northeastern India. Now, why these two places are important for drug trafficking? If you know that there is something called Golden Crescent. Okay, this is a hub of the drug traffickers, not only in Asia but across the world. Now, there are three places. One is Golden Crescent, the other one is called Golden Triangle. Golden Triangle, consisting of countries like Cambodia, Laos, and Vietnam, and Golden Crescent, consisting of countries Afghanistan, Iran, and Pakistan. Now, these are two hubs, and India is located between these two major hubs of drug trafficking. So this is a area through which majority of the drug trafficking passes through, either from Myanmar or from Bangladesh or from this particular region. Okay, from Bhutan or Nepal or through India. So that is why this region is having left-wing extremism problem, the problems of terrorism, problems of drug trafficking, and the problems of insurgency movements in Northeast. Now, whatever the problem in India you take, whatever the challenges in India you take, now almost all the challenges are concentrated in this location because they can go. I mean, these the people, the left-wing extremism or terrorism or drug trafficking or insurgency, all these groups, they can move to any country. Either they can escape easily from Indian forces or from other forces. Like that is why they take shelter in this particular region, because they can go here, they can go here, they can go here, they can come here, or they can even go into Northeast. Now that is why many internal security challenges are located in here. So this particular point is a very vulnerable point from India's not only external security point of view, but the internal security point of view as well. I hope this is clear why the Siliguri corridor or chicken snake is very important from internal security. Now that is why India wanted a good association with Sikkim, because India do not want any challenges in this particular region, because it is already having a lot of its share of challenges in this particular region. That is why India do not want any new challenges. Now I hope you understood why Sikkim is important from India's point of view, why India is important from Sikkim point of view. Any questions till now? Okay, now the background of Sikkim from 1947 to 1974. 1947 to 1974. Again, how to remember? Just reverse the two digits, last two digits, 47 to 74. It was given the status of protectorate state. From 74 to 75, it was given the status of associate state. And from 75 onwards, it became a full statehood. It was given full statehood, becoming the 22nd state in India. Now, the story of Sikkim did not end from here, and in 1975, it was one of the success stories of integration. Okay, so screen sharing is not enabled. Could you please enable that?
Sir, it's
Okay,
already
thank you.
done.
So please a quick confirmation again. You are able to hear me, see me, and view the desktop as well. Okay, thank you. Now we were discussing about the integration of Sikkim. Why? Yeah, please, someone wants to speak. Okay, so the story of Sikkim was in three phases: before 74, after 74, and after 75. Now, once Sikkim and India both felt that there should be greater association, so in 1975, the 36th Amendment Act was passed, repealing Article 2A and Section 10 of the Constitution. Now, Sikkim became a full-fledged state in India. Now, you can see that Sikkim, the success story of Sikkim. Okay, now this is one of the best examples of integration, because we see that Sikkim after 1947 1975, when Sikkim was given full statehood. Now, there was a political stability in Sikkim, like unlike a lot of other small states, okay, a lot of other small states which are, which where there is no political stability. Okay, now Sikkim is an example of a success story, though it is a very small state, okay, at the border area. Okay, it is at the border area and one of the least populated states. If you know that Sikkim is one of the least populated states and second smallest state after Goa. Okay, now despite all this, at the very border area, and that too with a country like China, with despite all these reasons, Sikkim is one of the most peaceful states in India. And Sikkim is also in news for multiple reasons. Can anyone tell me why Sikkim is in news recently? Doklam, very good. Yeah. Doklam. It happened way back.
And recently, yeah. Recently there was a standoff between Chinese troops and the Indian troops.
Yeah. But it is on Ladakh mostly, not in the middle sector. It is in the western sector. But why Sikkim is in news? Any other reason? Okay, Sikkim is in news for multiple reasons. One reason is the longest serving chief minister of India, the Pawan Kumar Chamling. Okay, Pawan Kumar Chamling became the longest serving chief minister of India. Like last year only, he broke the record of Jyoti Basu. Till that point of time, the Jyoti Basu of West Bengal was the longest serving chief minister of any Indian state. So I think in 2019, he broke this record and he became the longest serving chief minister. Okay, why this is important? Because this is, as I told, one of the most politically stable states in India. Okay, where in many small states, like in Jharkhand, okay, many the governments are not able to complete their 5-year term. That is, before their 5-year term, the no confidence motion would be passed. And governments are toppled one after the other. Generally, this happens in a new state and a small state. But despite all this, Sikkim was one of the most politically stable states. Okay. And also, Sikkim is in use because of the, it is a completely organic state, if you know that. So the fertilizers are not permitted in Sikkim. It is an organic state, a good success story for agriculture, Indian agriculture also. And Sikkim is also in use because of recent inauguration of airport in Sikkim, in Gangtok. Okay, till that point of time, there was no airport in Sikkim. There was only Baghdogra Airport in West Bengal. Okay, and the Sikkim airport has been inaugurated by Modi last year and it has been expanded. Earlier it was just an airbase, now it became like an airport, a full-fledged airport for travelers. Okay, and also there is one important pass in Sikkim. If you know that, if you see the map of India, okay, if you see the map of India, now this is China, let us take, this is Jammu Kashmir, this is China, this particular place is somewhere Sikkim. Now, there are different passes for crossing the Himalayas. Okay, I hope you know that the Himalayas are not very friendly to pass, even with today's technology. Okay, even with today's technology, transportation and communication technologies, Himalayas are not very easy to pass. Even the aircraft which is flying in Himalayas is something different. Okay, because they have to fly more than a height of like 16 kilometers, 20 kilometers, where the peaks are the tallest peaks in the world are something like 8 kilometer, 9 kilometer range. So that is why the aircraft which is designed is also different. Like not the commercial aircraft can flow over the Himalayas. There is a special aircraft. Now I hope you all know this one. Okay, that Himalayas are very difficult to cross. Now in Himalayas there are some natural places to cross. They are called passes. Passes in Himalayas. There is one important pass in Sikkim, which is a major trade route between India and China. Can anyone name that pass? Nathula. Very good. Very good. Nathula. Nathula is the pass in Sikkim, which is a major trade route between India and China. NATHU, Nathu, LA. Nathula. Okay. Now, this Nathula was also opened up somewhere, I think 2005, 2006, it was opened up because of the relations between India and China improved during this time. Okay, and also Sikkim is in news because of the Kailash Manasarovar Yatra. I hope you know that Kailash Manasarovar Yatra, which is one of the important pilgrimages for the Hindu community. Where is Kailash Manasarovar? Which country is it in? Yeah, Tibet. It is in Tibet. That is in China. Today, the Manasarovar is in China. Now, for Manasarovar, there are different routes. So, one route is through Nathula. The other route is through Nepal. Now, many pilgrims take this Nathula route. Okay, many pilgrims take this Nathula route because the infrastructure is very much improved in this particular region. The China has made a lot of infrastructural projects in this region, and compared to Nepal, where the terrain is very inhospitable, so many pilgrims take this particular route for going to Manasarovar. So on one side from India, there is one side is Nepal route, which is a shorter route, but because of lot of you can say barriers. Okay, one is we do not have proper infrastructure in Nepal, and moreover, there are very high mountain ranges in this particular region. So many pilgrims take the Sikkim Nathula route to reach to Manasarovar, though it is a very longer route. Now, I hope you understood why Sikkim is in news because of multiple reasons. So whenever you are preparing a topic, okay, whenever you are preparing a particular topic like Sikkim or any particular topic per se, try to do not just stop at 1974 or 1975. Yeah, someone wants to speak. Please. Otherwise, keep your microphones on mute. Okay, unless you wanted to speak. Okay, now Sikkim is in news for multiple reasons. So try to find out like why each particular state in news. So this way you are able to cover your current events as well when you are preparing your history. Okay. So, any questions till now on the story of Sikkim? Okay, I'll take it as a no then. Okay, moving on to the next thing, next topic of our discussion. So, what I suggest is many students are not very clear on the map of Northeast. So this is a very clear map of Northeast if you do not know. So spend some time in understanding and remembering the places in Northeast. Like for example, if I ask you, what are the demands of Nagaland movement? I told Nagaland movement, Nagaland wants to have the territories not only in Nagaland but also in the nearby states. If you do not know if Nagaland shares a border with Mizoram or Tripura or Meghalaya, you will not know why Nagaland in Nagaland movement, why Manipur and Arunachal Pradesh are involved, why Mizoram is not involved. Because Nagaland wants some territories here, some territories in Assam, okay, some territories in Manipur, and some territories in Myanmar also. If you know, this is the country Myanmar. Okay, now Nagaland movement, that is some sections of Nagas, they believe that we are never a part of India, so we should be given independence because there are tribes who are living there, and India-Myanmar border is not a naturally formed border. I hope you know that it is not a naturally formed border because India-China border is a naturally formed border. Like we had traditionally or historically, we had Himalayas separating India and China. India-China border is a naturally formed border. India-Sri Lanka border is a naturally formed border because we have a strait separating India and Sri Lanka. Okay, these are naturally formed border. Whereas India-Myanmar border is not a naturally formed border because there are no dividing lines between India and Nagaland geographically. These are man-made borders. Because there are man-made borders, the manning of these borders is very difficult. And moreover, the terrain is also very difficult. Like it is a very hilly terrain. Okay, and it is because it is a hilly terrain, there are tribal groups. And for tribal groups, they are having their homes this side of the border as well as this side of the border. but because of the independence of India, their families were separated. Okay, their relatives, their friends, their families, their villages were separated. In fact, I was seeing a documentary how the India-Myanmar border was there. So some places, India-Myanmar border was not only through hills and forests, but it was also through villages. In fact, it was also through their homes, the India-Myanmar border. Like in some cases, like the your living room is in India, your bedroom is in Myanmar. Okay, so this is where the people were completely disrupted because of the India-Myanmar border. And because of the relations between India-Myanmar border, the people who were living there were not allowed to move to Myanmar, and people in Myanmar were not allowed to come to Nagaland or India. And because of these reasons, the people here, they felt that we are not being treated like Indians because we are not given any of the rights. We are separated from our families, separated from our kith and kin. That is why we wanted a unified Nagaland. Now, if you understand this reason, you'll be able to write down more about or more understand more about the movements called Nagaland movement or the organizations called NSCN. Again, there is the movements are not completely unjustified because on some hands, the atrocities committed by the Indian side as well as Myanmar side were also projected by the organizations like NSCN, Naga's Nationalist Socialist Council of Nagaland, NSCN, which has various branches. Okay, which has there were various splits and mergers, and splinter groups started emerging out of this NSCN. There was earlier called Naga Nationalist Council, and if you could recollect, yesterday we were seeing that in 1963 there was AZ Faizo. He was demanding a separate country out of India, and to satisfy the needs of the people of Nagaland, the NSCN, sorry, the NNC, Naga Nationalist Council, was made a deal with Government of India, said that a sufficient autonomy will be given within the framework of Indian Constitution. Okay. Now, this is a story of Nagaland, but it do not the story of Nagaland did not have a happy ending like Sikkim. Now, Sikkim, you can say it has a happy ending after 1975. But the Nagaland does not have a happy ending. The Jammu Kashmir does not have a closure. Now, if you see that the problems in Jammu Kashmir, problems in Nagaland, in some places they were success. Like in Manipur, it was a success. Like in Sikkim, it was a success. But in Nagaland, it was not a success. In Punjab, our forces have succeeded in, you can say, in dealing with Khalistan movement. But the same security forces were not successful in Jammu Kashmir. Now, this is where you have to understand why in some places India was successful, why in some places India the challenges are remaining. Now, if you understand in this way, you will be able to write a better answers in your exam. So do not study history, post-independence history as something which happened in the past. Now, you have to be able to correlate to the present events. So that is where you are being asked about these questions in multiple papers. Trace the Naga nationalist movement and justify their demands. Maybe you have to write in a positive light, or write about the framework agreement recently the Indian government has made with NSCN. Okay, then you should be knowing what are the splinter groups with which we are fighting, with which we are making an agreement. Okay, so this would be helpful in your polity paper, in your IR paper, India Myanmar relations. It would be helpful in your internal security paper also. Okay, how internal security, insurgent movements. Okay. But I suggest have a good idea of the map of Northeast. Okay, until you know the geography, you do not know much about what are the movements, what are the insurgent groups, and there are multiple reasons why the people of Northeast feel disconnected. I told one reason is identity. Okay, you know the identity problem in Northeast because the people of Northeast were not treated as people of India. Okay, in many places, that cultural biases are there. Okay, not only in the common or the common population, but also in the educated class. Okay, even in the well-educated class or those who are in the higher positions, there is always is kind of you can say they look down at the people of Northeast, and they many Indians still do not feel that they also are part of India or they also are like that. Okay, because there is a identity problem. And there is problems of representation. You know, there are problems of representation. Can anyone tell me how many seats are there in Lok Sabha in total? 545, very good.
545.
In Lok Sabha, there are 545 seats. In Rajya Sabha? 245, around maybe approximately 245, I'll take. Okay. Now, 2545 seats in Lok Sabha and 245 seats in Rajya Sabha. Now, how many seats does Uttar Pradesh have in Lok Sabha? 82, very good. Now, Uttar Pradesh more than 80 seats, whereas each of the northeastern states, except for Assam, they have only one seat. They have only one seat in Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha. That is why the Uttar Pradesh is politically important at the national level compared to that of other states in the northeast. Now, that is why you can always see Yogi Adityanath in news, but you do not even know the names of the chief ministers of Meghalaya or Manipur many times. I've noticed this. It is because, as per Indian constitution, Indian constitution says all states are equal. But in practice, some states are more equal than others. Okay, if you know that in Lok Sabha, five states have majority. That is, if five states decide, the 23 states, whether they agree or not, it does not matter. That is, the five states with maximum amount of population, like Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Maharashtra, or West Bengal, these are the top five states where they have the majority. If they have the majority, they can actually block any resolution in Lok Sabha. That means the five states are more important than the remaining 23 states, because we have the allocation of seats based on population. The same thing goes with Rajya Sabha also. Even in Rajya Sabha, the allocation of seats is based on population. I hope you know which census of population. Can anyone tell me? 1971, very good. Perfect. It is based on the population of 1971. Again, in Rajya Sabha also, the allocation of seats is something which has to be resolved. Now, just to compare, in the case of USA, in USA there are 50 states, and the upper house of USA is called a Senate. In Senate of USA, each state is sending two senators, irrespective of its size, irrespective of its population. That is, in the case of USA, all the states are equally represented in their upper house. But in the case of India, some states are having majority, some states are always in minority. Now, this is one of the concerns for the people of Northeast, that we are not being represented properly, either in political sphere, either in bureaucracy, or in judiciary. Okay, either in political sphere or in bureaucracy, if you take the top chief secretaries or top IAS officers. Now, you can see the representation of Northeast is not as per their population should be. Okay, now despite that, we know that one of the most educated states in India are in Northeastern India. If you know that, like after Kerala, highest literacy levels are in Northeast. Now, they are having very good literacy levels. Despite that, their representation is very poor in political sphere, in bureaucracy, or in almost all the spheres. Either you take culture, maybe in the sports, or maybe in the you can say movie, cinema, or politics, or any of the spheres you take, the representation of people in Northeast is very much less, and that is the reason they feel that we are not represented properly. Okay, that means India does not only belong to the people who are living in some places of India, but India belongs to the people who are living here. That is why there are groups who believe that we are never part of India, or we were not treated on par with other Indians. And I hope you also know that there were atrocities against the people of Northeast, even in cities like Delhi, even in cities like Bangalore. Okay, even the cities like Bangalore, where we call it as cosmopolitan, or people from different places and technical capital of the country. Even in places like Bangalore, you can see that there is a discrimination which is there against the people of Northeast. I hope you understood the problems of Northeast, the identity problem, the representation problem, and despite having very high literacy levels, the employment opportunities are very limited. Okay, the employment opportunities are very limited. And one reason is infrastructural problems, border areas, insurgent groups, internal security problems, ड्रग ट्रैफिकिंग. आई होप दिस गिव्स ए ब्रीफ पिक्चर ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम्स और द चैलेंजेस विच आर देर इन नॉर्थ ईस्ट. नाउ वॉट स्टेप्स टेकन बाय द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया टू डील विथ द प्रॉब्लम्स इन द नॉर्थ ईस्ट. कैन एनी वन टेल मी वॉट इज द मिनिस्ट्री फॉर द नॉर्थ ईस्ट कॉल्ड? Can anyone tell me what is the ministry for Northeast? Is there a ministry for Northeast?
There is one department of Northeast region, but I don't know.
Okay, it has been given, ministry level,
I think it is under
Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region. Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region. MODONER, MODER. Okay, Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region. Go through what are the schemes run by Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region. This becomes very important for your exams. Now, what steps the government of India is taking for the development of Northeast? Okay, what are the infrastructural projects which are going on in Northeast? If you know that there are a lot of infrastructural projects which can be asked in your prelims, like the road connectivity project, the railway projects, and you can say, infrastructural projects like creation of dams and the river Brahmaputra. On the river Brahmaputra, there are multiple projects which are in the pipeline. There are power plants which are being set up in Northeast, and Northeast has a huge hydroelectric potential. Now, what steps are taken by Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region to solve the problems in the Northeast? Like insurgency problems, the development problems, the connectivity problems, the infrastructural problems. All these challenges, they are addressed by Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region. Now, this is very important for your, you can say, preparation. Like, what are the steps taken by Government of India? Here, you'll get a lot of data. Okay, visit the website of Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region. Go through the policies, schemes. Okay, so where you'll get a lot of details for your preparation. Any questions till now? Please stop me if you have any questions or if I'm just rushing out. Please do stop me. Okay, then we'll move to the next one. Just to sum up the discussion we had from 1951 to 2020, how India was. You can see this graphic. Okay, so this shows how India was changing every 5 years or 10 years, how the new states were created and existing state like Jammu Kashmir was ended. Now, which article in the constitution talks about this one? About internal reorganization of the states. Yeah, very good. Article 2, just to be very specific, Article 2 deals about the annexation of new territories, that is acquired territories, Article 2. Whereas Article 3 specifically deals with the internal reorganization of the states. So there is Article 3 in the Constitution. Now, what does Article 3 say? So who can create a new state? Either state legislature or parliament. Parliament. It is only the parliament. Only parliament has a power to create the new state. Now, if you want to reduce the area, if you want to increase the area, if you want to change the name of the state, okay, if there is a merger of the state, if there is a transfer of territory, change in boundary, everything is done under Article 3 of the Constitution. Now, if you want, I can just quickly show the Article 3 just for your reference. Okay, now you know the procedure under Article 3, mentioned under Article 3. Does anyone know the procedure?
President of India gives some bill to the states, then the state will give recommendation to the parliament, then parliament passes the bill with or without the acceptance of state.
and finally it becomes an act. The
yeah,
majority is
yeah,
simple
perfect,
majority.
perfect. Okay, very good. Now I hope you all of you know the procedure which is mentioned in Article 3, but just for your sake, I'm just showing the Constitution of India. I hope everyone saw the Constitution of India. If you're not seen, have a look at Constitution. This is the preamble. Okay, this is the preamble of the country, and the part one deals with Union and its territory. Union and its territory, and Article 2 deals with the acquired territories. If Parliament is acquiring, if the government wants to, India being a sovereign country, it can acquire new territories. That is mentioned in Article 2. And if you see Article 2A, here it is mentioned in brackets. 2A was repealed by 36th Amendment Act 1976, which was added by 35th Amendment Act 1974 it was added, in 1975 it was repealed. The Article 2A was repealed. Okay, if you see Article 2, Article 2A. And Schedule 10 was also added to the Constitution. Today, Schedule 10 deals with, can anyone tell me what is the subject matter of Schedule 10 today? Anti-defection law, very good. Today, Schedule 10 deals with anti-defection law, but earlier, the Schedule 10 was dealing with Sikkim, the governance of Sikkim. Now, because this can become very important questions for your prelims examination, because they have already asked this question, which what is the subject matter of the original Schedule 10 of the Constitution? Okay, they gave Sikkim, they gave anti-defection law, because many students just mug up Lakshmikant at the end. Okay, so they thought that it is only anti-defection law, but you should understand that Sikkim also had Schedule 10 in the Constitution when it was an associate state from 1974 to 75. Now, this one, Article 3 of the Constitution discusses in detail about how the bill has to be passed. Okay, now you can see here, the procedure is also mentioned in Schedule 3, the whole procedure. Again, when you are reading the Constitution of India, when you're reading different articles, I strongly recommend spend some time in reading the actual article in the Constitution. Just directly reading the Lakshmikant or D.D. Basu or whatever polity textbook. So spend some time in reading the Constitution, because if you want to understand like Article 370, do not just jump into the analysis of Article 370, because there the authors would give their opinion. So first of all, you should know what is there in Article 370. So suggest you to read the article which is there in Constitution directly. So any questions till now? So I hope everyone received the Lakshmikant book, or everyone has the Lakshmikant book. Okay, so suggest you to read the Lakshmikant in detail. Now this is all the static. Yeah, please.
Sir, I have one.
In India, there is a demand for creation of separate states or merger of separate states. What is the status in other countries like US or Canada? I mean, will there be similar demands there, and how will the government deal with that?
Now, to understand how it is there in other countries, now in the case of other federal countries, like in the case of USA. In the case of USA, what happens is, it is a completely federal country. Because it is completely a federal country, the creation of this new state can be done only by a constitutional amendment. But in India, we need not have constitutional amendment. It can be done by a simple law. If you see the Constitution, it is saying that Parliament by law, it can form a new state. That is, we need not have constitutional amendment. Constitutional amendment requires 2/3 present and voting, whereas a law requires 50% present and voting. Now, getting 2/3 present and voting in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha is very difficult for any political party, even for a political party like BJP, which has won with such a massive majority. Making constitutional amendment is very difficult, because just for the sake of understanding, we were discussing that there are 540 seats in Lok Sabha in total. Of this 540 seats, can anyone tell me how many seats are there with BJP? Not 320.
Around
320
320.
would be a huge success. 270 around, 270, 280, I think. Okay, so BJP and its allies have maybe 300, more than 300, but only BJP. Only BJP, I'm not talking about NDA. Only BJP has, I think, 270 or 280 seats. Now, what is two-thirds of 540? Come on, what is two-thirds of 540? Yeah, it is 360. Now, getting 360 seats, that means BJP alone cannot pass a constitutional amendment until it has the support of other political parties. Sometimes even opposition should be on board. That is why passing of GST took almost 10 years. If you know that GST was a constitutional amendment. That is, I'm talking only about Lok Sabha. In addition to Lok Sabha, there is Rajya Sabha. Again, the current government does not have the same numbers in Rajya Sabha. Okay, in Rajya Sabha also it has to be passed by 2/3% in voting. In addition to Rajya Sabha, at least 50% of the states should give their ratification for constitution. Simply put, constitutional amendment is a very rigid provision in constitution. Now, here in Article 3 says that constitutional amendment is not required. Okay, that is what mentioned in Article 4 of the constitution. If you see Article 4 just after this, it says that Article 2 and Article 3 are not constitutional amendment under Article 368. Maybe if you remember or read your Lakshmikant, it clearly says that Article 2 and Article 3, they amend Schedule 1 of the Constitution, the state names and union territory, Schedule 4 of the Constitution, the allocation of seats in Rajya Sabha. But though Schedule 1 and Schedule 4 are amended, we will not consider Article 2 and Article 3 as constitutional amendment for the purpose of Article 368. That means simple law. That means if the BJP decides, it can create a new state. It need not depend on any other political party. That means it gave massive powers to the union. The constitution itself gave huge powers to the union for creation of states. But in the case of countries like USA, there should be a constitutional amendment. That is why in USA, there are 50 states, there will be 50 states. If a new state has to be created, it requires a constitutional amendment. But in the case of India, we can have one state, we can have 100 states. The next day, Modi government can say that we are not having 28 states, we will have one state. It is possible. It can say that there is no Karnataka, there is no Tamil Nadu, both are merged together. It is also possible. Because with a simple majority, any particular government would have simple majority. That's why it has formed the government. Okay, it is very at the mercy of the union government. The state governments are there. In theory, we say that state governments are, you can say, they are not under union government, but in practice, state governments are always under the union government. That is why the federalism is a concern in the case of India. But in other countries, like in US, which is a truly federal country, creating a state requires constitutional amendment. But in India, it need not have constitutional amendment. And that is clearly mentioned in the constitution. Constitutional amendment is not required under Article 368. Because this procedure is very rigid. The procedure mentioned in Article 2 and Article 3 is very flexible. And that is why Indian constitution has flexible elements as well as rigid elements. Some provisions are rigid, some provisions are flexible. I hope I answered your question. Okay. Okay, thanks. Now, yes, what sir. Is more important here is all this we discussed is a static portion. What is more important is we have to understand the dynamic portion. Dynamic portion, what is happening now or what will happen in future? Okay, what will happen in the future? Now, whether the demands for the new states have stopped or not? The simple answer is no. Okay, the demands even after all these excesses have not stopped. Now, if you take the map of India and if you list out what are the states, what are the demands, you will notice that the demand for new states did not stop. Now, before going into the aspirant states, just we'll have a look at whatever we discussed in till now. Okay, now if you see, we were discussing about the 29 administrative divisions as of 1951 And from 1951, one after the other, we can see that in 1956 State Reorganization Act, 14 states and 6 union territories were created, and one after the other. So this picture shows the creation of all the states. Like Punjab was split into Haryana, and later Chandigarh Union Territory was created, and further later Himachal Pradesh was created, and 1963 Manipur, 1972 map of Northeast was changed. Okay, 1987 Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram and Goa were given statehoods. In the year 2000, 3 new states were formed: Chhattisgarh, Uttarakhand and Jharkhand. Okay, and 2014 Telangana, 2019 Jammu Kashmir, 2 new union territories were formed. Now this is what the gist of our discussion from 1956 to 2020. Now this is what we discussed from here, how we became like this. So any questions still in this particular phase? Okay, so we'll take it as a no again. We will move on. Now what would happen in after 2020? What would happen after 2020? Whether the demands for new states have stopped or not? The simple answer is no. Now these are all the aspirant states in India. Now if you see the map of India, in almost every state there is a demand for a new state. In almost every state you can see, for example, if you take the case of Maharashtra, there are demands for Vidarbha. Take the case of Gujarat, there are demands for Saurashtra. Take the case of Tamil Nadu, there are demands for Kongu Nadu. In Karnataka, there are demands for Kodagu, there are demands for Tulu Nadu. Okay, in Andhra Pradesh, again the newly formed Andhra Pradesh after 2014, there are still demands for formation of a new state within Andhra Pradesh, that is the Rayalaseema region, because this is most one of the most underdeveloped regions in Andhra Pradesh. And in Odisha, the coastal region. In if you go north, in Madhya Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh, you will see the demands for Bundelkhand, Bagelkhand, Awadh, Purvanchal, Harit Pradesh, Mithila region in Bihar, and in West Bengal, demands for Gorkha land. In Assam, demands for Kamtapur, Bodo land. If you go further to Assam, there are demands for Dimarji, Karbi Yanglong. And if you see Rajasthan, the Maru Pradesh, here there are not only demands. Welcome back. Quick confirmation, please. You are able to hear me, see me, and view the desktop. Yeah, thank you. So we were discussing about the aspirant states in India. That is, the demands for new and new states did not stop even after 2020. That is, even with the creation of all these states, okay, we can still see that there are demands in whole of India. Now if you see, now these are all, like you can say, good demands. Okay, if you go further to the northern part, they are demanding a separate country. If you go to here, they are demanding a separate country. If you go here, that Khalistan movement, they were demanding a separate country. Now in the case of Northeast, it's completely confused. Who want what? Okay, because some groups want separate country, some groups want separate state, some groups want more autonomy. Okay, there it has become a lot of you can say groups which are active in Northeast. Sometimes they themselves do not know what they want. They themselves do not know with whom they are fighting. Okay, sometimes they fight together, sometimes they fight against each other, sometimes both fight with Indian government, sometimes Indian government they take the help of the Chinese troops, they take the help of Myanmar, the other countries also, sometimes cross border support they will be getting. Okay, now all this has become very complex situation. Now the demand for aspirant states in India did not stop. Now across the country you can see that there are demands for new and new states. Now if you belong to any of the states, for example if you belong to Maharashtra, now try to understand why the Vidarbha region is demanding a separate state. Okay, maybe in detail. If you belong to Gujarat, try to find out why there are demands for Saurashtra. Now from your home state you should be knowing the what are the movements. You should know, at least for your home state, the background in which it is formed, and also you should know what are the demands in your state. For example, if you belong to West Bengal and if you do not know anything about the Gorkhaland issue, okay, this might not give a good indication to the examiner. Now we can see that the separatist movements, that is for the creation of new states, did not stop in India. Now what is the solution for this? Maybe I suggest take this as an assignment, one question, or maybe I'll give you one question. First, okay, I'll give you two questions. Maybe you can take the first question. The first question: Is there a need for second state reorganization commission? Is there a need for second state reorganization commission? Now the first state reorganization commission from 1953 to 1956, Fazal Ali commission, has given a complete reorganization setup in the country. Now on the similar lines, instead of creating the states in a very ad hoc manner, okay, that means if you see, the creation of states is in a very ad hoc manner, not on sound welfare grounds. Many of the times the creation of the states has been done based on the political motives. If you know that the Telangana was created in 2014, and in 2014 there were general elections. Okay, if you know that the creation of the states is not always been done on the basis of the welfare of the people and the welfare of the state, but majority of the times it has been done on the political motives of this one. And in fact, whether the smaller states, creation of smaller states, is good for India or is it bad for India? Now when you are preparing for, as I told, competitive examinations, you should be very cautious. That is, you should not exceed the word limit or you should not exceed the time limit. So what I suggest is just make a flowchart like this, or a small diagram like this in your notes, and try to write smaller states. Okay, on smaller states, write down the positives and write down the negatives. Maybe some 4 points here, 1, 2, 3, 4, some 4 points here. Okay, or maybe negatives and positives, maybe I'll put it the other way. What are the negatives and what are the positives of smaller states? That is, creating smaller state, is it good for India or is it not very good for the country? Now just take this exercise. I suggest do not write the story again. Okay, write down the positive points on one side and what are the negative points. When you are writing your exam also, if you try to represent in this manner, this would give a clear identification to the examiner that you know. You can write down the story whether you agree with or not as a conclusion, but what are the examples of smaller states? what are the negative examples of smaller states. For example, the success story. In some states, the smaller states have performed better. In some places, the smaller states have not performed as better as they should be. Now you can take this as a next question. Okay, first question is there a need for second state reorganization commission? Second question is, are smaller states effective in their governance? Okay, again, I'm not saying in a language the UPSC will say in a more polished language. Okay, I'm just giving you the gist of whatever we discussed. Now, these are very probable questions for your exams as well as personality test. Now, because considering the situation across the country, okay, demand for more and more autonomy, demand for creation of new states, demand for in separatist movements like Khalistan movement or insurgency movement or Jammu Kashmir movement, is there a creation of smaller states? Would that be good for India or not? Now this is where you have to write down a balanced answer. Again, when you're writing the answers, do not write your opinion. Okay, so I hope you will not write your opinion, rather you'll write the facts, substantiate with facts. You should get as many points as possible why smaller states are better and why smaller states are not very good. Give examples which substantiate with a lot of examples. Like for example, in the case of Jharkhand, you will notice that the smaller state has not performed very well as it should be, despite a lot of mineral resources. If you know that Jharkhand has a huge amounts of mineral resources, and despite all this, the mineral resources, Jharkhand did not perform well. Whereas the states like Chhattisgarh, they have registered sometimes even a double digit growth. Now, when you are writing your answers, you should be substantiating with facts. On one side, we can see there is an economic growth in Chhattisgarh, but at the same time, there are problems of the Naxalism which were on rise in the states like Chhattisgarh. Now, in the case of Telangana, the states like Telangana, they have performed well after their creation. But states like Jammu Kashmir states like Jharkhand did not perform well. Now, what is the problem? The states like Goa has performed well. States like Sikkim have performed well, but not the states like Nagaland did not perform well after their creation. Now, where are the flaws? This is where you have to be very cautious when you're writing your answer. Now, as a student of history, when you're evaluating a performance of a state, you should not evaluate based only on political parameters. Okay, you should not based only on political parameters. Rather, you should be focused more on social parameters, economic parameters. Yes, there are political parameters. Okay, whenever, for example, if historian is evaluating whether Modi has performed well or not, they will not evaluate based on their own, you can say, likes or dislikes. Rather, they will be analyzing in a very objective manner. Okay, someone wants to speak? Yeah, if not, please keep your mics on mute. Okay, maybe if you want to evaluate a performance of a government, when it has taken over the government and when it has left office, what are the indicators? What is GDP level? What is literacy level? What are health indicators? Whether it has done good job on this? And by the time, yeah, please, someone wants to speak. There's a lot of noise. Please keep your microphones on mute, otherwise, unless you want to speak. Okay. Now, if you see, if any historian or a scholar is evaluating a performance of a particular government, it should not be based on your own likes or dislikes, but it should be in a very objective manner. As I told, what are the GDP levels, what are literacy levels, what are health indicators, when that particular government is taking office, when that particular government is leaving office, whether there is an improvement or not, whether the human development indices have increased or not. So this is where you have to evaluate the performance of a particular government. Again, do not go with any political biases, whether you are right wing or left wing, it does not matter. It should be based on some, you can say, parameters or statistics like HDA. I hope you know that there is something called HDA, Human Development Index. Okay, so on similar lines, you have to evaluate the performance of a government, whether smaller states are effective in governance, whether you agree or not agree. Okay, here your answer should be balanced. Your answer, you should be taking a view based on a very objective parameter. It does not matter whether you agree or not agree. For UPSC, what it matters is what made you to come to this conclusion. Okay, see, if you write that you agree or not agree, it does not matter, you'll not get marks. But what UPSC is wanting you to know is on what basis you have arrived at this conclusion. Whether you are informed about all the statistics, then you are taking this position, or without any objective analysis, you are taking this suggestion. Now for this, I'll send some good articles, the newspaper articles, something else, the linguistic barriers and reorganization, some good articles and IGNO material, which would be helpful in your exam. So whenever you are preparing for the competitive exam, as I told, write down a very simple, short, concise notes, okay, creating all this. So when you are writing the same answer in your polity paper, you should be more focused on Article 3. You should be more focused on the creation of state, the procedures which are passed, followed in the parliament, ordinary bill, money bill, simple majority, special majority. But when you are writing the same answer in history, you can write from historical perspective. When you are writing the same answer in your economy paper, you should be focused more on the economic parameters. When you are writing the same answer in your internal security paper, you should be focused more on internal security issues. Okay, so when you are writing the answers, in which paper you are writing, you should be knowing. But for your preparation, I suggest a holistic understanding of the topic, whether small states are better or not better in almost all senses, in historical senses, in political senses, in internal security challenges, in economic viewpoint. In all these viewpoints, try to write a balanced answer covering 360 degree view. Again, all this should come in one half sheet, whether aspirant states should be given statehoods or not. When you're writing about this, again, do remember that each of these were having their own demands. For example, take the case of Vidarbha. Maybe the development could be a major reason. Take the case of Rayalaseema. They're talking about development. But unlike here, maybe in the case of Kongu Nadu or the places like Kodagu, it is not only on development, because they are already developed. Okay, they are already developed. What they wanted is more identity. Some places they wanted identity. Some places they wanted representation. In some places, some movements are for more for development. The Saurashtra can be based for development, because when we say Gujarat is developed, not whole of Gujarat is developed. There are some places which are left behind. Okay, we can say that the Andhra Pradesh is developed, but not the regions in Rayalaseema. Because if you see within the state, there are some regions which are left behind the developmental process. Even if you see Karnataka itself, you'll see a lot of difference between North Karnataka and Bangalore. Okay, the way the Southern Karnataka is performing, the way the Northern Karnataka, the Hyderabad Karnataka region. Okay, the way the Hyderabad Karnataka region is performing, the way the southern part of Karnataka is performing. The way Bangalore is performing, the way some portion here is performing. You'll see that within Karnataka itself, there is a lot of differences. Okay, in the same way, within India, there are lot of other differences. That is, the development which is happening in Delhi, the development which is happening in Mumbai, development happening in Bangalore are not India. There are lot of other events which are happening across the India. Okay, the development might not be happening here. The development is not happening here. The development is not happening here. That is why there are different insurgency movements or terrorist movements or left-wing extremist movement. Okay, now if you understand all this relationship, then you will be able to write a balanced and a more, you can say, logical answers in your exam. So this approach you have to adopt, you can say, in your practice itself. So when you're practicing, try to read multiple articles, but try to make the notes in a very concise form. So any questions in this topic? Yeah, please.
So, apart from the challenges that are existing right now for the states, there is one more challenge with respect to the borders of the states, right, where people belonging to borders speak both the languages, right?
So that is always a challenge which will always remain, like when it's, so you cannot clearly identify which is a border and which is not. For example, if you take the places like Kanyakumari, they were claimed both by Tamil Nadu and Kerala. Okay, because the people who are living here, they speak both the languages. They speak Malayalam, they speak Tamil Nadu, Tamil. Okay, both the languages they are speaking. In fact, they are associated with both the states. Now, there are always challenges, those who are situated in the border areas. The same thing goes in the people living on the border of Karnataka and Maharashtra. Because sometimes both states wanted to take care of them. Sometimes none of the states want to take care of them. Okay, now this happens again and again. Okay, if you see at the border areas, the development is poor. Now I'm talking only at the state borders. At the take of country borders, it is much more difficult. The people living here, there is literally no development here. That is why you can see that the border areas are not developed in the case of India. That is why you can see a lot of challenges which are coming across the border. Now, when the border areas are not developed, if you do not have proper infrastructure in the border areas, this would create multiple challenges to internal security. Now, if you're talking about border areas within the country, again, yes, you're very correct that the border areas, those who are living in the border areas, they are often neglected by both the states, or sometimes they are, both the states want them depending on the development. For example, when Andhra state was created, I hope you know, you recollect that in 1953, Andhra state was created. When Andhra state was created, both the so-called Andhra state and Tamil Nadu, both wanted Chennai, both wanted Tirupati, because they were developed. Okay. In the same way, when Gujarat was created in 1960, both Gujarat and Maharashtra, both wanted Bombay. Okay. Both claimed that Bombay is ours. Like, because Bombay is having lot of Gujarati businessmen. So, what Gujarat claimed was Bombay belongs to us because it is we who made Bombay. The same thing case goes with Hyderabad. Now in the case of Hyderabad, like the people of Andhra Pradesh, they claim that we played an important role in development of Hyderabad. So naturally this Hyderabad belongs to us. But Telangana was not in a mood to give to Hyderabad. The same thing, Bombay was not given to Gujarat. Madras was not given to so-called Andhra state. Now these kind of demands, as I told, sometimes both wanted to lay claim, sometimes both do not want to, both do not want. In the same way which happened during the time of Punjab and Haryana, both wanted Chandigarh. That is why the Union Territory of Chandigarh was created. Okay, if you see the Union Territory of Chandigarh, it was created because both Punjab and Haryana both wanted Chandigarh. So that is why Union Territory status was given. So if you see historically, that is those people who are at the border areas. Okay, so sometimes both the states lay claim, sometimes both the state neglect. Now this is where the question comes, what happens to the people of border areas? Sometimes I was seeing a news where a person living in Kanyakumari was voting in both the elections, in Kerala elections, Kerala assembly elections, as well as Tamil Nadu assembly elections. So one media person approached him and he asked him, why you vote in both the elections? He said, I'll get money from both the parties. Okay, now this is a different story, but I'm just saying, like, sometimes the people enjoy benefits of both the states. Sometimes they were neglected by both the states. Okay, or many a times they are neglected by both the states. Now this is a concern for living people living in border areas. That would always be there. Okay. And in fact, again, the internal security challenges would also be there. If you know the story of Veerappan. Okay, now why Veerappan was not caught for a lot of years? Because he was just moving between two states, between Karnataka and Kerala border. Now, he was just moving from Karnataka border to Kerala border, or sometimes to Andhra Pradesh border. Now, he was located here. Now, whenever Tamil Nadu becomes aggressive, he will just move to Karnataka. And whenever Karnataka becomes aggressive, he will just move to Andhra Pradesh. Now, this show the security lapses as well. Okay, that means the state police cannot cross the border, whereas criminals can cross the borders very easily. And that is why they become haven for the, you can say, the groups, the criminal groups, which are very active in the border areas. The same thing goes with Maoist struggle. The Maoist left-wing extremists, you can see that they are very active in the borders of this one, like Telangana, Chhattisgarh, and Madhya Pradesh, where Maharashtra, these regions. Okay, they are very active here. They are very active here. The reason why they are very active here is they can escape to any state, because the state police has limitation, but they do not. They can directly cross the borders. So I hope I gave you answer to the question. Okay, or you are expecting something else? Did I answer? Please let me know. Okay, so border areas are always vulnerable.
Yes,
as I told, it is from internal security point of view, from development point of view. Okay, so always a challenge. So it is much more rampant in the case of international borders. In the case of international borders, it becomes much more turbulent. Okay, because there is not only state police who are dealing, but there is also the central armed police forces. In addition to central armed police forces, there are army who also sometimes takes the guard. And because of the presence of local police, army, as well as central armed police forces, there are multiple agencies. This would hamper the growth. Now, if you see, the border areas in India are not very much developed. Now, this is where, if the border areas are not developed, in fact, many of the times the local population do not know about the sensitivities of the issues. So that is why they allow the people from cross the border. Maybe if you know how terrorists are coming into India, okay, how terrorists are coming into India, because the border areas are not very developed, because the infrastructure is not very developed. They just cross the border, and the people who are living in the nearby regions, they also help them, thinking that they are just refugees. Maybe in the case of Jammu Kashmir, that is a problem, because the terrorists would come as refugees and they stay or take the help of the local population, because the local population is not very much aware about the issues of this. They think that they are helping someone. Maybe if you know how the 2611 attacks came to India, they came as fishermen. The terrorists came as fishermen. The same thing in the case of drug trafficking areas. Even in drug trafficking, it is the locals who help these people, the drug traffickers, because the locals, as I told, play a very important role, because they might not be aware what they are carrying. Okay, because they would be taken for granted by these groups, insurgent groups, drug traffickers, terrorist groups, okay, left-wing Maoist groups. All these would utilize or use them, okay, in making these areas vulnerable. So that's why the government has started with a program called BADP. It's an optional scheme called Border Area Development Plan. Border Area Development Plan. Go through BADP. What steps the Ministry of Home Affairs is taking for development of border areas. Okay, now again, when you are talking about border, you have to talk about border management. Now, border management in the case of India is also very difficult. Did I tell you what is the total length of land border of India? Can anyone tell me what is the approximate length of this whole border? Land border, or at least Indochina border, which is in use. What is the total length of Indochina border? Approximate. Yeah. Okay. Approximate 3488. Maybe, yeah. I'll take it as 3500 kilometers. Indochina border. Now, in fact, Indochina border is not the longest border India shares with. With China, we have a border of 3500 kilometers. With Bangladesh, we have the longest border. I hope you know that it is 4000 kilometers of long border. Just to make you understand what is 4000 kilometers. What is 4000 kilometers? Now, what is the total length and breadth of India? Can anyone tell me? If you travel from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, what is this length? If you travel from Arunachal Pradesh to Gujarat, approximate. yeah, around